respected MD sir and all distinguished guests, I am going to present subtle sensory nerve hearing loss and intratympanic steroids. Normal anatomy of the ear. This is the whole ear, and this part is middle ear. Tympanic membrane and three ossicles. This step is up to this region. The hearing loss which we got is conductive hearing loss, and beyond this region, this is sensory neural. This part is sensory part, and this is neural part up to the brain. So I am going to deal with this sensory neural hearing loss. If there is any problem in this part, it can be ear bags, can be any foreign body, can be tympanic membrane perforation, this ossicular chain may be necrosed, and this step is foot plate may be fixed, this middle ear may be filled with fluid, all these conditions may lead to conductive hearing loss. But if there is any problem in this sensory part or this neural part, then patient will have sensory neural hearing loss. And third variety of hearing loss may be mixed type, where conductive and sensorial both parts may be involved. In chronic cases of chronic suppurative otitis media, due to prolonged inflammation, there is some toxic particles which imbibe inside the inner ear, and it creates the mixed type hearing loss. Actually, this intratympanic therapy which came in my mind, I have tried in two cases. One case was we already gave oral medicine for around 21 days, and even then patient didn't get any improvement. Then I tried intratympanic therapy, but even after the intratympanic therapy, that patient did not improve. This is the structure of final structure of inner ear, where this is scala media, this is scala tympani, where perilymph is filled. This area is scala vestibuli, and scala tympani is filled with perilymph, and this is filled with endolymph. And when this step is foot plate, it's like a piston, then this perilymph in this cochlea vibrates. Due to that vibration, this resinous membrane also vibrates, which creates turbulence in this endolymph. In turn, in this tectorial membrane, there will be changes, movement of this tectorial membrane, which is attached to the hair cells, outer hair cell and inner hair cell. These hair cells get distorted. Because of that distortion, there is some potential generation of potential difference, and that potential difference is transmitted as this through this nerve fibers as hearing impulse to the brain, which we receive as hearing sound. So, regarding sudden sensory neural hearing loss, this first described in 1944 by this gentleman, D. Klee, and its incidence is 5 to 20 per 1 lakh of population. And in US, every year there are 4,000 new cases detected with this sudden sensory neural hearing loss. It is an idiopathic condition in most of the cases, and hearing is defined as hearing loss in three contiguous frequency of at least 30 decibels, and the duration should be less than 3 days. Good morning, sir. Some authors use at least 20 decibel loss to define sudden sensory neural hearing loss. Onset of hearing loss should occur in less than 72 hours, and the recovery rate without treatment is 32% to 79%, and it usually within 2 weeks of onset recovery occurs, and only 30% cases are reported with complete recovery. To define sudden sensory neural hearing loss, there should be no middle ear disease, and it is an otologic emergency. Clinically presents as sudden onset hearing loss of less than 3 days, usually unilateral. Only 2% cases are noted as bilateral. Left side possibly more common in different studies. And median age of the onset is 40 to 55 years. It is equal among males and females. And when patient goes for sleep and after getting up, suddenly feels that he is not listening with one ear. And hearing a popping prior to the hearing loss. Patient may feel fullness in his ear. And tinnitus and vertigo is also very common. There are many differential diagnoses given. This is infectious. It may be bacterial, it may be viral. Inflammatory disease like autoimmune disorders, Sjögren syndrome, associated with some eyes features also. Lupus, multiple sclerosis. Then trauma to temporal bone, acoustic trauma, like patient is listening sudden burst of loud noise, that can create sudden sensorial hearing loss. Perilymph fistula, when patient is excessively coughing, sudden pressure, this may lead to perilymph fistula. Then neoplastic disease like severe tumors, temporal bone metastasis. Ototoxicity may be aminoglycosides, aspirate, some diuretics also leads this problem. Then vascular adventures like thromboembolism, microglobulinemia, sickle cell disease, cerebral impact and TIA. And some congenital disease also presents as sudden sensory nerve hearing loss. So why this sudden sensory nerve hearing loss occurs? Many theories have been given. But till date, there is no clear-cut pathology as other idiopathic diseases. Most common theory is viral infection, and some histopathological findings are very suggestive of viral infection. There are temporal association of this disease with viral upper respiratory tract infection in 25% to 63% of patients. And serology also confirms that there is some viral infection in the body. The histopathology of human temporal bones shows atrophy of organ of Corti, spiral ganglion, tectonial membrane, and hair cell loss, and ravaging of myelin of the nerves. Then animal experiments confirm viral penetration of the inner ear. Second theory is vascular theory. Sudden onset suggesting infarction. This gentleman of Parliament demonstrated loss of cochlear microphone 60 seconds after occlusion of laryngeal artery in guinea pig. Then Burgers and microglobulinemia, sickle cell and fat embolism also associated with sudden sensorial hearing loss, suggestive of vascular injury. And some histopathological changes are also suggestive, like in guinea pigs, labyrinthine vessels occlusion lead to loss of spinal ganglion cells, mild to moderate damage to organ of Corti, and cochlear duct fibrosis. Still, it is controversial. And the third theory is intracochlear membrane rupture, loss of endocochlear potential due to mixing of endolymph and perilymph. And Bushen has some histological evidence indicating intracochlear membrane rupture. But nowadays it is fallen out of favor. And most likely it is combination of viral causes and vascular insert that leads to certain sensory nerve hearing loss. So, what are challenges? Actually, in our country, most of the people wait for some time that it may improve automatically, and by that time, that golden period of intervention is passed out. And it's a recovery rate, spontaneous recovery rate is around 50%, more than 50%. So, true incidence is not known. Patients with spontaneous recovery usually do not present to an otolaryngologist. Patient may present beyond what is considered to be therapeutic window. Etiology is still unclear, and relative paucity of studies examining treatments based on prospective double-blind or randomized control trials. So, when a patient comes with sudden sensory nerve hearing loss, we have to take a proper history. What is the progression of disease? For how long it is occurring? Complete head and neck examination, then we do some increase the pressure of external aortic canal to increase the pressure of middle ear and examine, evaluate the fistula signs. If patient is getting dizziness on elevation of pressure, then it may be due to some ruptured membrane in the inner ear. Then we have to do some audiometry tests. This most common is pure tone audiometry and speech reception threshold. In this speech discrimination score, we give some spondy words. One word is given for 3 times or 5 times. If patient is correctly repeating those words for more than 50%, that is considered as positive. And in this way, if his CS is more than 80% or 90%, it is known as it is called normal. If it is below 80, it is abnormal. Then tympanometry test is done to find any pathology in the middle ear or either any stapes fixation, whether station tube is blocked or not, like that. If necessary, we have to do BERA and otoacoustic emission. And if patient is complaining of dizziness, then we have to consider ENG. In around 1% of cases with sudden sensory nerve hearing loss, internal acoustic canal and CPA tumors are diagnosed. So MRI may be considered if there is associated some neurological symptoms. Then in younger patients, we have to do contrast CT of temporal bones to rule out any congenital pathology like Mondini's malformation or enlarged vestibular aqueduct. Then to rule out polycythemia, leukemia, thrombocytosis, or any condition where this vascular stasis is suspected, we have to do laboratory evaluation for like CBC, electrolytes, ESR. ESR will give some information regarding some inflammatory disorder, autoimmune disorder, then antinuclear antibody, or this is a specific for this sudden sensory nerve hearing loss. It is found in around 60 to 70% of cases. It is done. Then rheumatoid factor, for syphilis we have to do some tests, coagulation profile, thyroid function test, and lipid profile. Then regarding treatment, the main line of treatment is systemic steroids from ears. It reduces inner ear inflammation. It is non-specific and depending on time of therapy. If it is started within 24 hours, the best result is expected. It can be given orally or intravenous and very able to poor response for profound sensory neural hearing loss. It depends on the type of hearing loss and type of the frequency involved. If it is mid frequency, the prognosis is best. If it is a profound type of hearing loss, that is hearing loss is more than 90 decibels, then the prognosis is very bad. Cannot be used for all patients like diabetics, ulcers, tuberculosis, glaucoma. Then we have to consider intratympanic steroid therapy. Other modalities are also there, but there is no evidence that whether it will be useful or not. So most of the ENT surgeons do treat with combination of these things. Like our hospital, we give steroids and sometimes this vasodilators. For carbogen inhalation, we have to admit the patient because there will be fluctuation of blood pressure. So we have to monitor regularly. Then volume expanders like dextrans can be given, antivirals, we used to give this acyclovir. There are some studies and two prospective double blind randomized studies have been done on the evaluating therapy of sudden sensory neural hearing loss. One is by Wilson, which used decadrav and methylprednisolone. In some patients he used decadrav, in some patients methylprednisolone, and he included only those patients with 30 decibel loss over at least 3 contiguous frequencies in less than 3 days of duration and presentation within 10 days of onset with normal laboratory studies. 33 patients treated with steroids. Among these 33, Decagran treated patients were given 10 days tapering dose, and methylprednisolone treated patients were given 12 days tapering doses. 34% were given placebo, and 52 patients were not treated. And these are results. All with mean frequency loss had complete recovery, and 14% had vertigo. 76% with profound loss had no recovery, and 24% had partial recovery. 79% had vertigo. And those patients who had loss at higher frequency, that is 4 kHz and 8 kHz groups, were combined, and recovery with steroids were 78%, and recovery in placebo group were 33%, and no adverse effect side effects of steroids were noted in intratympanic steroid therapy. And some prognostic factors which were there, vertigo does not statistically significant, age less than 40 years favorable for recovery, and type of audiogram, mean frequency loss with best recovery, profound loss less likely to have recovery, and loss between 40 decibel to 85 decibel, that is middle range, severe to moderately severe, more likely to respond to steroid therapy. So this is the graph. These are mid frequency, higher frequency, 4 to 8, and this is lower frequency. This is profound hearing loss. No response to steroids in profound hearing loss. This area wherever having favorable recovery. So when steroids and placebo are compared, the chances of recovery is 5 times. When compared with untreated controls, chances of recovery are 4 times. Then controls and placebo almost equal. And steroid versus all controls, more than 4 times chances of recovery there. Another gentleman, Cinnamon, conducted a study in 2001 with 41 patients stratified by types of audiogram, that is flat type, mid frequency loss, low frequency loss, and high frequency loss. And improvement at least 15 decibel changes of pure tone audiometry. Means if it is 60 decibel loss, recovery should come below 45. Loss would come below 45. And 4 treatment groups were for 5 days of therapy. Prednisolone was given 1 mg per kg body weight per day. Placebo given, carbogen given. Actually, conducted carbogen and steroids. Effectiveness of carbogen and steroids. And carbogen was given for 30 minutes 6 times daily. Room air inhalation. And the results were with steroids. Improvement was 80%, with placebo 81%, with carbogen 55%, and placebo inhalation 77%. So it is not statistically significant. And trends, low frequency loss improved more, high frequency loss improved less. Patients without vertigo have better outcomes. It suggests that if vertigo is there, means more extensive involvement of the disease, so chances of recovery is less. Regarding intratympanic therapy, starting with Barney in 1935, we used lidocaine for tinnitus treatment. Then this gentleman used streptomycin for Meniere's disease. And in 1973, Mr. Bryan used steroids for a patient with facial paralysis. Administration of steroid to middle ear round window niche membrane directly targeting the inner ear, in hope that some amount of the steroid will imbibe inside the inner ear and it will reduce the inflammation. Very little systemic absorption is there, so may benefit patient for whom systemic steroids are contraindicated. Higher concentration to end organs may salvage hearing loss when non-responsive to systemic steroids. Only one prospective double-blind study has been done. There are many studies done of this trans-symphatic injection of steroids on cochlear blood flow or auditory sensitivity and histology in guinea pigs. Dexamethasone 4 mg per ml and saline, these two things were compared. with 30 G needle through enteroinsular part of tympanic membrane. And the results were 29% increase in cochlear blood flow within 30 seconds without change in auditory sensitivity measured by BERA. Increase in cochlear blood flow was sustained for at least 1 hour, but no histological changes found. In another guinea pig model, dexamethasone and methylprednisolone were used, and it was found that dexamethasone was more potent than hydrocortisone, but methylprednisolone was more potent than hydrocortisone. And it also designed intratympanic steroid treatment routines for a variety of inner ear disorders. Twelve patients not previously treated for sudden sensory neural hearing loss onset within 6 weeks of treatment. Actually, divided patient in two groups. One is early group, one is late group. Late group means beyond 6 weeks. And given intratympanic methylprednisolone or dexamethasone with 27 G needle, eight patients with methylprednisolone 40 mg per ml, one had full recovery, three had partial recovery, and four had no recovery. Four patients with dexamethasone 2 mg per ml dose was given, with two patients had partial recovery and two patients had no recovery. So there are chances of 50% with some recovery. Three patients developed otitis media, which resolved with antibiotics. There are many studies. This is the microwig which was used by Silverstein. Actually, it is a grommet. First, we insert the grommet, and this is gel foam. We make a beak of gel foam, size 1 mm by 9 mm, and it is inserted through opening of the grommet, and it is kept for the treatment. And in the middle ear, I can drop the steroid was instilled in the hope that through this gel foam, this medicine will come reach to the round window. From round window, it will imbibe inside the inner ear. This is the diagrammatic picture when this grommet is inserted here. This is the beak, and this is the round window. This is the oval window. So, various people have studied the effect of steroids with variable results. Somebody saying 47% improvement, somebody saying 20%. So, still it is debatable how much effective it is. So, what is the advantages of intratympanic steroids? It may be used when systemic steroids are contraindicated or refused. Greater concentration is achieved at target end organ, may be performed in outpatient setting, and possible use for salvage of hearing, and it is relatively low complication rate. What are challenges? Still not well established as primary treatment strategy. Dosing is variable. Some people say something, some people say something. So there is no ideal dosing right now. Best delivery technique, whether it should be given through the needle or through microwave. What are long-term effects? Not known. And why does it work? Only sometimes. So what are take-home messages?